Kuya, may naririnig ka? Naririnig
wala.
Ba? Wala din. Wala.
Good evening, Ate Sylvia.
Good evening po.
Good evening.
Siguro public.
Derin maano ni Ate Monina. Ayun. Bakit natin?
Medyo sa'yo dyan. Ang sakin natin. Sa'yo dyan, really.
Wala. Kanina meron.
Narinig mo? Diyan, diyan?
Wala namang ano, sharing, music sharing. Hindi na yung maririnig pag hindi ko share. Share music.
Huh?
Good evening, Kuya Grex. Welcome po. Music lang te. O yung screen. Alam mo yun? Screen, click screen share, tapos advance. Click advance. Taas sa gitna.
Na-stop ko na yung...
Tapos music and computer sound only. There. Greg, kilala mo si ano? Hidden, that token?
Mukha na siguro.
Josh. Josh, that token. Tagabagi
sa mukha, siguro.
Si Hidden yung spouse ko, tagabagi. Nandiyan. Pag-alam. Pero nasa ano siya ngayon? Vietnam na.
Thank you sa lahat. Thank you. Rachel, Ate Marisa. Good evening po sa lahat.
Ayong gabi. Good evening.
Good evening.
Ayun pa po. Parang paan natin? Sada wala ay kuya? Okay. Before we officially begin our lecture for tonight, I want to welcome you, brothers and sisters. Good evening. But before that, we will sing the CID anthem. Tunugok anthem. Begin. Let's sing together.
Oh,
Good evening, brothers and sisters, once again. But before that, before we start our lecture for tonight, may I invite Ate Maricel to do the opening prayer.
Okay. Everyone, join me in prayer. Good evening, our most loving Heavenly Parents, and our glorious servants of heaven, earth, and humankind. We are truly grateful and thankful for all the blessings we receive every day in our lives and for guiding us and protecting us always in everything that we do. And as we begin our session tonight, I invite you, Divine Presence and the Parents, to dine with us and be with us as we move on for the next chapter. And I'm praying also for our lecturers tonight and our elders, leaders, brothers and sisters joining us. Holy Parents, we're praying for your guidance all the time. Thank you so much for everything. This is an important prayer in behalf of my brothers and sisters. In your parents' name, with a grateful heart, Aju.
Aju.
Yes, good evening, brothers and sisters. Musta po ang lahat? How are you po?
We're good. I'm good. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, good evening.
And before we officially begin po yun. Kuya, magre-read ka pa ba tayo or hindi na?
I can start.
Okay. So now, to finally begin our lecture for tonight, I wanted to introduce first our lecturer. Of course, yeah, let's prepare our hearts to really welcome our amazing brother. Yeah, for the lecture for tonight, Kuya Herwin Kalinawan. Yes, welcome.
Okay, let me share my screen. Good evening. Kumusta? Welcome back again. And so, yes.
Yung internet natin pa.
All right. So once again, ilang beses na. Magandang gabi po sa lahat. Good evening to everybody. And yes, po. I hope na you already eat your and so that focus in tonight's lecture. So all right. If since we have this principle of creation, we also have the principle of restoration, and that is the part. Principle of restoration is because, as we knew already about what happens during the fall, in our first ancestor fell, and then we need. So the restoration process also follows principle, because God is a God of principle. So in order for us to be restored, we have to follow certain principles. And it was already explained by previous lecture last time. So it's kind of recap yung ngayon sinasabi ko, a short recap that, about indemnity, paying indemnity, one of the principle of restoration Yes, and then laying the foundation of substance and foundation of faith in order for us to receive the Messiah and become one with God. So those are the principles. And we've studied also last meeting about the family of Adam, how the foundation of faith and substance were being failed. So now let us proceed to section 2, providence of restoration in Noah's family. Let us understand here how the family of Noah laid the foundation of substance and faith. This is one of the these are the factors that we need to fulfill in order for us to receive the Messiah. So this is a principle of restoration. Before we can receive the Messiah, we have to lay the foundation of faith and substance. And what are those foundation of faith and substance that had been laid in Noah's family? So we will know from this lecture. So, and those failures also centering upon Noah's family. So God has predestined absolutely the fulfillment of the purpose of creation, and his will remains unchangeable. So the predestination of the fulfillment of God's will is absolute. His will is unchangeable. But again, there is what we call the human portion of responsibility. Even though God absolutely predestines everything into goodness, but we have this 5% portion of responsibility that matters upon the fulfillment of God's purpose of creation. So from here, even though Adam's family failed, you know, the heart of God never gives up. God still find a way to restore his children, but in accordance with the principle. So how? So let's study more. God, upon the foundation of the loyal heart which Abel demonstrated toward heaven, chose Seth in his place. From among Seth's descendants, God chose Noah's family and commenced a new chapter in his providence. So because of this, of the foundation of the heart of Abel, so God and then Cain killed Abel. So God cannot stop the providence. Adam had another son, Seth. And then from Seth, the providence started again. So from the descendants of Seth, and then it was after, since what I have said earlier, that the principle of restoration follows the principle of God. So which means from Seth's descendants, from Adam, 10 generations after, God chose Noah. And we will know later why it is 10 generations after, not 9 generations, not 8 generations. We will know later. So this is the principle. And this is based on God's number. Why is it 10 generations? God will still wait for 10 generations in order to choose another central figure, and that is Noah. So we will know later. Noah's family was responsible to fulfill the indemnity condition to restore the foundation of faith, and then the indemnity condition to restore the foundation of substance. They were to restore to indemnity the foundation for the Messiah, which Adam's family had failed to lay. So since Adam's family failed to lay the foundation for the Messiah, which is laying the foundation of faith and substance, so Noah's family take the responsibility of Adam's family. So Noah's family is another set of family, central figure, central family that will start another providence. It's centering upon the providence of God. So now, since it follows the foundation of faith and substance, so let's study kung ano yung, what are, what is how the foundation of faith was being established. So since we've studied already, right, in order to receive the Messiah, we have foundation of faith and foundation of substance. So now let's study first how this foundation of faith being laid in Noah's family. So in foundation of faith, para ma-restore. So it is really needed. This is really needed in order for restoration. Okay? So this is a principle. This is nobody can deny with this one or stop with this one. This is a principle. So foundation of faith. So in foundation of faith, meron tayong tatlong kinakailangan. Three aspects needed. Central figure, condition, and then indemnity period. Object, or the second one, central figure, object for the condition, and indemnity period, or numbers. Because God works in numbers, and God is a God of numbers, and God is a God of principle. So, ang central figure is Noah. So, as what I have said, why Noah? Because God works 10. The meaning of 10, number 10, why is it 10 generation after then just God chose Noah? So, because the meaning of 10 is the principle point of view. 10 is unity, and it also emphasizes perfection. So, which means, so when we study the stages, the formation, growth, and completion, right? And then at the top of the completion, there is a perfection. So every formation, growth, and completion, there is also a formation, small formation, growth, and completion. So 9 plus that at the top of the growth, at the top of the completion stage, which means 10. So when we reach 10, it is perfection. And when you reach perfection, you have unity between God and you. So God has to choose the number 10 for him to start again a providence. So that is why God chose Noah. Another point is because Noah have this absolute obedience to God, absolute faith, that 420 years. God already could observe how faithful is Noah towards God. So that is another point where God chose Noah. And then because, as what I have said earlier, it's because also the foundation of the heart of Abel towards God. So again, the central figure is Noah. So now, what is the condition, the object for the condition? So kailangan ng object. And let's continue. The object for the condition by which Noah was to restore the foundation of faith was the ark. So yung ark yung object of for the condition in order to restore the foundation of faith. It was the indemnity condition for the restoration of the cosmos, which had been lost due to Satan, Adam's fall, and signified the new cosmos. So, an object for the condition is ark. Why is it object for the condition? Because here, when we talk about faith, we cannot deny that really Noah have this absolute faith towards God. Why? Because God instructed him to build an ark at the top of the mountain, which is very questionable at that time. When you were the people around Noah at that time, would you believe Noah? I don't think so. Me also, if I am around with Noah at that time, and Noah is preaching like, please join me, come with me and build the ark at the top of the mountain. Me myself, I will not follow Noah. That kind of faith, it is laying about the foundation of faith, and this object for the condition that Noah had to pay. So through the ark, so God instructed him, and to build the ark, not just 1 year, 2 years. Like, di ba pag ano? If we build some, even like ship and or mga bangka or boat, big boat, it takes maybe let's say 1 year, that's the maximum, or 2 years, or But at that time of Noah, it's very interesting, right? It takes 120 years. And 120 years. How come me myself? I think just months and then I will give up. We cannot really fathom the plan of God. We cannot really fathom the power of God. Actually, it's really to understand the heart of God for us fallen people. But Noah have just really he could really understand the heart of God. He could really understand His will. That is why he is willing to follow God no matter what. So because of that condition, building the ark, Noah was able to build the foundation of faith. And it doesn't complete from the ark. There is what we call number, indemnity period. So ano yung indemnity period niya? Number, numerical number, what I'm trying to say. So after the ark was completed, God judged the world with flood for 40 days. Its purpose was to eliminate sinful humanity in order to raise up a family who would relate only with Him. Through the 40-day judgment, Noah's family offered the ark in the manner acceptable to God and restored through indemnity the foundation of faith. So the central figure is Noah. So we have already the condition, the object for the condition, which is the ark. So, and another one, the third one is the numerical period. So we have this 40 days, blood judgment. Why is it necessary to have this 40 days? Okay. May sinabi dito si Father. Okay. I mean, this is from exposition of divine principle. And Father, why did God choose a 40-day period for the flood? Since the goal of restoration is to complete the four-position foundation, God worked to raise up each of the 10 generations from Adam to Noah by setting up an indemnity period to restore the number 4. In total, the period from Adam to Noah was an indemnity period to restore the number 40. Due to the lustfulness of the people of those days, however, this indemnity period of the number 40 was defiled by Satan. Therefore, God set up the period of the flood judgment at 40 days, the indemnity period to restore the number 40. By fulfilling the numerical, why did God choose 40-day period for the flood judgment? I'm going to explain it briefly. It's already said here, but briefly. So when we study again, from Adam to Noah, it is 10 generations, right? And then, every generation, there is a four-position foundation. There is a family. So in the family, there is a four-position foundation. But at that time, it's because of the fall, four-position foundation, then 10 generations. 10 generations multiplied by four position foundation, and that is equivalent to 40. So since that time, it is not the lineage of Satan. It is not the lineage of God. It is the lineage of Satan. So in order for God to restore this one, God chose number 40 during the flood in order to restore the creation. So that is the why is it 40? It's because of the 10 generation, restoring the 10 generation from Adam to Noah and the four position foundation. So 10 times 4 is 40. So the 40 period is really necessary for to separate from Satan. So by fulfilling this numerical period of indemnity, God intended to restore the foundation of faith. The number 40 thus became characteristics of dispensation for the separation of Satan, which are necessary for restoring the foundation of faith. So we can therefore conclude that the foundation of faith has been established, centering in Noah's family. So meron ang foundation of faith. So meron tayong central figure, we have central figure, we have an object for the condition, which is the ark, and we have indemnity period, which is 40 days. So it means the foundation of faith is complete. So what else do we need? The other thing that we need, the other foundation that we need is the foundation of substance. So we have foundation of faith, and now let us study what is the foundation of faith centering upon Noah's family. What is the foundation of substance centering upon Noah's family? Okay, we have already the foundation of faith. So what is the foundation of substance? So Noah's son, Shem and Ham, were to have stood in the position of Cain and Abel, respectively. Had they then succeeded, in the substantial offering by fulfilling the indemnity condition to remove the fallen nature, they would have laid the foundation of substance. So in Noah's family, since this is a restoration, so Noah's family have to restore what is Adam's family have failed. So in Noah's family, there should also be an Abel and Cain. So yung Abel, Ham is the Abel and Shem is the Cain. So there should be an Abel and Cain centering upon Noah's family. This is also the principle of restoration. So for Noah's family to make an acceptable substantial offering, Ham, Noah's second son, and the central figure of substantial offering was to restore the position of Abel. So now, from here, the foundation of faith is how to build a foundation of faith. It is to indemnify a condition through indemnity condition to remove the fallen nature. So we have to remove a fallen nature within us, within Ham and Shem. They should have removed their fallen nature, which they inherited from Adam and Eve, or from Cain and Abel as well. So, in order to lay the foundation of substance. Now, ang Abel kasi is si Ham. So, to inherit that position as Abel, so Ham, in order for Ham to inherit the position of Abel, all he have to do is to unite with Noah. Because the central figure in foundation of substance is Ham, the Abel type. So he is the central figure. But in order for him to take that position as Abel, all he have to do is to unite with his father, Noah. And if he can unite with his father, one in heart, then the foundation of substance will be established. So in case of Noah's family, it was Noah, not Ham, who made the symbolic offering. Therefore, for Ham to stand in the position of Abel, as one who has succeeded in making symbolic offering, he had to become inseparably one in heart with his father, Noah. So Abel should become one with his father in order to lay the foundation of substance. When we talk about the relationship between Ham and Shem, they're not fighting, actually. They are in unity. But that is not enough to remove the fallen nature. Ham should going to unite with his father in order, because his father Noah is laid the foundation of faith, right? And if Abel laid the foundation of substance, the foundation of faith and substance must unite. So Noah and Ham must unite in order to receive the Messiah. But the problem is, there is a failure. And yeah, I know you know already, but let me explain it. Let me rephrase you again from this point. This is very important. Unity between parent and child. Very, very important. Even in our life, whatever we are doing in life,
the unity between parent and child, the unity between student and children, the unity between the government and the people is very important. If there is no unity, there is a destruction. So let's go back here from the time of Noah. What happened? Noah, does Ham united with Noah? Let's see. According to Father, Noah cannot restore by himself. So he cannot restore by himself, according to Father. Just as Adam needed his son Abel for his own restoration. Noah's son must unite with his father for the restoration of the father. Otherwise, the fallen father-son relationship cannot be restored, and they cannot return to the original world. It is the child who begins the providence of salvation. It is originally the father's task. However, since the father fell, the child must take it up. So here we can see that the restoration doesn't only applies on the parent. It goes together with the father-son relationship. And also it goes with mother and son relationship. When we study later about this mother-son relationship. So the relationship between the parent and child is very important in order for the restoration to be accomplished. That's the point here. So in Ada, here in Noah's family, in order for this to lay the foundation of substance and faith and to receive the Messiah, so Noah and Ham must unite. So let's see what's happened. Let us examine how God worked to help Ham become one in heart with Noah. So in the book of Genesis chapter 9, verse 20 to 26, reports that when Ham saw his father laying naked in his tent, felt ashamed of Noah and stirred up the same feelings in his brothers, Shem and Japheth. So we studied about the story of the Bible, right? After the flood, and then after the 40 days flood, and then they're living already in the outside of the ark, planting. And at that time, yeah, see, Noah is planting these grapes. And then, of course, you are very happy, and then you have to make enjoyment because of that victory that Noah has been laid. But the problem is he was drunk. But there is a purpose, right? There is a purpose why he was drunk. It is to test the faith of him. So let's study more. Providence to achieve Ham's artistic oneness with Noah. When Ham felt ashamed of his father's nakedness, an act that resembled Adam and Eve's covering the lower parts and hiding, made a condition for Satan to enter. Hence, this feeling act constitutes a sin. So since we are talking about principle, we're talking about restoration. So in Noah's family, he needs to restore Adam's family, right? So let us go back what happened during the time of Adam and Eve. So when Adam and Eve commit the sin, they cover the lower parts. But before that, during the innocence time of Adam and Eve, when they are very during their childhood, they are free, they are naked actually. And God was very happy. God is happy looking the innocence of his children naked. So they don't have this feeling of shame at that time. But when they commit the sin, they knew that it was not the right time. So they covered their lower parts. Covering their lower parts, it is how Satan was able to invade the family of Adam. So the covering the lower parts in Adam's family has to be repeated in Noah's family. So in Noah's family, Noah is naked. And when was when it happened, it happens after the creation, after the ark, right? After the 40 days. The making of 40 days, by the way, the making of ark, by the way, is it symbolizes cosmos. Three stages, and within as what we observe, within the ark, there is animals. The animal symbolizes creation. Then the family of Noah symbolizes humanity, right? And yeah, within the ark, it symbolizes the new cosmos. And after that one, so it would really happen na mangyayari talaga na Noah will be naked in order to test him, in order to restore what happened during the time of Adam and Eve. So consequently, Ham could not restore to indemnity the position of Abel, from which to make the substantial offering, since Ham thus failed to establish the foundation of substance, the providence of restoration in Noah's family entered in failure. So during this time, when we read the Bible again, the story of Noah's nakedness. So what happened is that instead of Ham was not able to unite with his father, because ang laging failure doon, the failure of Ham was he felt ashamed toward his father. When he saw his father laying naked, he felt ashamed. And he even asked Shem and Japheth to do the same, to feel ashamed as well. And then they covered the Lord, they moved like backwards, and then covering the naked body of Noah. So from this failure of Noah not uniting with his father, feeling ashamed with his father, repeated the time of Adam and Eve. So Ham was not able to restore this failure. Ham was supposed not to feel ashamed toward his father. So the connection between the parent and child, they should have been one in heart. But Ham could not unite with his father. So this results the failure of the foundation of substance. The foundation of faith there has been laid. The problem is the foundation of substance. The problem is Ham. So because of this, since the foundation of faith was not established, therefore, the foundation for the Messiah is also ended in failure. So the providence of restoration in Noah's family ended in failure. They failed because Ham did not unite with his father. So why did God test the sons through Noah's nakedness? So Noah's position right after the flood was much like that Adam after the creation of heaven and earth. After Adam and Eve fell, they felt ashamed of their nakedness. So that is after they fell. They cover the lower parts with fig leaves and hid among the trees of garden, fearing that God one would see them. This shame was an indication of their inner reality, for they have formed a bond of blood ties with Satan by committing sin with their sexual parts. By covering their lower parts and hiding, they express their guilty consciences, yeah, which made them feel ashamed to come before God. So they are guilty. God wanted to recover the joyful heart which had felt when looking at Adam and Eve in their innocence before the fall, by taking delight in the innocence of Noah's family. To fulfill such a profound wish, God had Noah lie naked. So there is a purpose. Noah had to lie naked. Purpose of that, had Ham been one in heart with Noah, regarding him with the same heart and from the same standpoint as God, he would have looked upon his father's nakedness without any sense of shame. Yun dapat yung mangyari. That's supposed to be happen. But him failed uniting with his father. So what are the lessons from this Noah's family? First, in walking the course to laid out by heaven, we must be humble, obedient, and enduring. So we should have this kind of, when receiving a mission from parents, from our leaders, it is really important to have this kind of character, being humble, absolute obedience, and enduring. You know, when I observe, you know, Sir Julius, right? Of course, everybody knows Sir Julius. When I observe Dr. Julius Malikdir, and yeah, I am a driver here, and I'm with him many times, driving him, talking to him. We talk a lot, actually. And, you know, one thing that I really appreciate from him is being humble. I shared this on Facebook when I shared this about Sir Julius Malikdim, then humility. So my point is, when we have this kind of character, really, people were going to look upon you. But let us not forget, not too much humble. And Sir Julius have that kind of character, not too much humble, but he's humble. Because if you have this too much humbleness, you know what happened with John the Baptist, right? People misunderstood that John the Baptist is too humble, but actually it's doing against Jesus' mission. So we have not too much humble, but we have to look to balance, and this humbleness, we should have this one, especially if you are a leader. It applies to everybody. Humbleness and obedience, and added in addition to this, absolute obedience and enduring. That sometimes we cannot fathom the plan of God. Di natin naintindihan yung mga plano ni God pa. Or yung mga, we don't understand our Abel's direction, God's direction towards us. All we have to do is to obey. All we have to do is to endure within ourselves and pray that why God have given me this kind of responsibility. And always stay humble. Yeah, it really applies. I hope that we could reflect from this one, from Noah's family. Second, the providence in Noah's family teaches us about God's conditional predestination of the fulfillment of his will and his respect for the human portion of responsibility. So God's conditional predestination. So in Noah's family, we have this portion of responsibility, God's conditional predestination. So it always teaches us that the responsibility of a person is really important. Even though the fulfillment of God's will is absolute, that's what I have said earlier, but God's will is absolute, but the fulfillment of his will is conditional. So it depends upon still the human portion of responsibility. So third, despite the fact that God has driven arduously for a long time to find Noah and raise him up as a father of faith, when his family could not fulfill his responsibility, God, though regretful, did not hesitate to abandon him and choose Abraham in his place. So even though Noah already fulfilled his mission, right? He has this foundation of faith already. He has this absolute faith already towards God. He is obedient toward God. He is humble. He is humble. He endures everything. But it's because of the failure of his family, God did not hesitate to abandon him and choose Abraham in his place. Because the providence, the lesson from this one is if we fulfill our responsibility, if we failed our portion of responsibility, God will choose another person who is better than us. If we fulfilled our if we failed our mission now, God will choose another person. God will not hesitate to abandon us. God will choose another person who is responsible than us. But the problem is that person will going to indemnify greater indemnity. We're going to receive greater indemnity. And we cannot afford that to happen. So fulfilling our portion of responsibility right now is very important so that God will not prolong his providence. And if God will prolong his providence, God will feel pain again. And I hope it would not really happen within our family. Every one of us in our family, we have this actually restoration. We have this restoration within our family. We've undergone this principle of restoration. If we fail, the cosmic providence will not prolong, but our family, the providence of our family will prolong, but the cosmic will not, because it's already been laid by true parents. So yes, and according to Father, if Noah had understood the principle, he should have proclaimed before his family the 40-day flood judgment, which I have accomplished through 120 years of toil, will have nothing to do with whatever mistakes you make in the future. Father has always held some sort of rally or proclamation ceremony after the end of the providence. This is like tying two knots on the handkerchief. The top knot and the bottom knot are entirely separate. So making proclamations is like tying knots. When there are two appropriate knots, no matter how wrong it goes to the bottom, it goes up to the top because of the knot. Had Noah made such a proclamation, even with Ham's mistake, the foundation built by Noah could have stood, and indemnity could have been lighter. According to Father, his rallies and proclamations are times when he reports to God, "I have triumphed up to this point," and declares to Satan, "I have achieved this much victory so that you can invade no more." Thereby, tying knots of victory simultaneously in physical and spiritual worlds. So Father is talking about here, proclaiming. You know, when Father have this rally events, Father will proclaim that events will bring victory before that events, not after the events. Why is it Father? You sabi to. Why is it Father that proclaims victory before the events happen? It is because in order to take strongly take the victory from over Satan. That is to kunin yung victory ba yung determination ni Father to have this victory over Satan. And that is why Father proclaims many times even before the events happen. And it also applies in Noah's time, sabi ni Father. So he, in analogy with Noah's time, even if, sabi niya, even if Ham failed uniting with him, he should have, sabi nito, the foundation built by Noah could have stood. Had Noah made such a proclamation, even with Ham's mistake, the foundation built by Noah could have stood and indemnity could have been lighter. So even though Ham failed, have these mistakes, if Noah still proclaimed the victory, the indemnity could have been lighter. It would not have been more difficult during the time of Abraham. It would be easier, like that, what I'm trying to say. So yes, that is the family, the providence of restoration in Noah's family. And I do hope that we've learned from this Noah's family, especially of this, the lessons that we'll learn from here, the importance of laying the foundation of faith towards God and substance in order to receive the Messiah. So in our daily life as well, in our mission as well, even ourselves, what are those foundation of faith and foundation of substance we've been established? So do you have any, what is your foundation of faith? If I'm asking you right now, what is your foundation of faith? Do you have any? So if none, then let's build now. And what is your substance, foundation of substance? So let's build now. So anyway, I'm going to share more later after the lecture. So to end this lecture, I would like to say thank you for listening and good evening.
Thank you once again, Kuya Herwin, for that profound lecture for the section 2. Yeah, and now, as we studied about the providence of Noah's family, I wanted to, hindi natin patagalin yan. Let's welcome na si Ate. Let's welcome Ate Melina for our second lecture for tonight.
Good evening. I would like to let me share my screen. Ha? Oo. Good evening, brothers and sisters. To continue with the providence of restoration in the three families of Adam, Noah, and Abraham. We are now in section 3, the providence of restoration in Abraham's family. So, Sir Herwin have discussed the providence of restoration in Noah's family, how they have, how Noah have fulfill the foundation of faith, but then his sons was not able to fulfill the foundation of substance, so that ultimately the foundation for the Messiah, which is the purpose of this providence of restoration, was not fulfilled in Noah's family. So God have absolutely predestined that the purpose of his of creation would one day be realized. Therefore, God called Abraham in place of Noah. Because of the failure in the fulfillment or the fulfillment of the providence of restoration in Noah's family, God chose Abraham in place of Noah. So what is the providence of restoration? What is the main purpose of the providence? For us to understand more, what is the purpose of the providence of restoration? It is to restore human beings into their original position as sons and daughters of God, or as children of God without original sin. So, this is the very purpose of the providence of restoration, so that after restoring their position as sinless children of God, they can continue growing up into individual perfection. And then after individual perfection, they need to fulfill family perfection, then to the fulfill perfection of dominion. And that is, in short, the purpose of the creation and the, which is the three great blessings. So first, that's the reason why, and the one who will fulfill this and will show us humanity on how to fulfill the providence of restoration is through the Messiah or the second Adam. So that's the reason why in the providence of restoration, we need to, the families of Adam, Noah, and Abraham need to prepare for them for the coming of the Messiah. And in order for them to prepare for the foundation of the Messiah, they need to lay the foundation of faith and foundation of substance. So after being successful with this, they can now they have already fulfilled the foundation of the Messiah, and they are now ready to accept the Messiah. So Abraham's family was to restore the foundation for the Messiah and receive the Messiah upon that foundation. Thus, Abraham had to restore through indemnity the foundation of faith. So it is Abraham who was to restore the foundation of faith. So the foundation of faith is the mission of Abraham. And his sons had to restore through indemnity the foundation of substance. When we say foundation of faith, which is the mission of Abraham, as well as Noah before Abraham, is that the foundation of faith means being one with God, one in heart with God, or fulfillment or obeying the word of God. That is the meaning of the foundation of faith. And when we say a foundation of substance, which is the mission of the sons of Noah, in the same manner, the sons of Abraham is to fulfill the foundation of substance. After Abraham become one in heart with God, so that oneness of heart of Abraham with God must be able to be inherited by his sons. So his sons must be one in heart with Abraham, just like Abraham has become one in heart with God. Abraham was to inherit the mission of Noah and thus the mission of Adam. In this capacity, he represented the restored Adam. This means that the mission of Abraham was accumulated. So the failed mission of Adam and Noah was accumulated in the time of Abraham. So that if Abraham becomes successful in fulfilling the foundation of faith, he will stand or he will be represented as the restored Adam. So when we say restored Adam, he will stand in the position of restored Adam, the sinless Adam. So he become, he restored the position of Adam from sinful to sinless, child of God, just like before the fall of human being. So in the providence of restoration, it must be clear that God is only looking for a restored Adam. Somebody that is not a simple Adam, but a restored Adam, an Adam who is without original sin. And ultimately, after Adam become a restored Adam, he will also find a restored Eve after restoring Adam. Abraham was to restore to indemnity all the conditions which has given to Noah to fulfill, but which were lost to Satan due to Ham's sin. So Abraham was to restore all the failures of Noah during his time. And also, since we know that Noah has been successful in laying the foundation of faith, but his son's Ham failed to lay the foundation of substance, ultimately the providence of restoration in Noah's family becomes a failure. First, the condition which Noah's family lost to Satan were the 10 generations of Adam to Noah. We know very well that God has waited to purify again the lineage from Adam to Noah before choosing Noah in his generation. So there must be a purification period so that before Noah, before God was chosen by Noah. And that's what Sir Herwin have explained to you. So this was lost, this condition of restoration or purification was lost due to the failure of Noah's family. So that Abraham need to restore all this which this failure again. To restore this true indemnity, God chose Abraham to inherit Noah's mission after an indemnity period of 10 generations. So the same, and 400 years had passed since Noah. So when God chose Noah after Adam's family, after Abel, it needs to restore our indemnity period of 10 generations. Also, God chose Abraham after 10 generations to purify the lineage again. So thus prolonging the providence of restoration. The second set of conditions which Noah's family lost to Satan was the position of the father of faith and the position of son. The position of father of faith, since we know very well that in order for Noah to build the ark, he built the ark within 120 years. So that this is the faith of Noah. If we truly examine and read again the Bible, the true father of faith is Noah, given the 120 years building the ark. And also the second set of condition that was lost due to Noah's family's failure is the position of Ham, the position of the filial son of God, which is because Ham is standing in the position of Abel, being the second son of Noah, and Abel also is the second son of Adam, which is this second son, we know very well in the providence that these, they are, the second son are representative of goodness, and these are the second sons are favored by God because they represent not because they are absolutely good, but because they are represent the lesser evil. To assume the role of the father of faith in place of Noah, Abraham had to make a symbolic offering in faith with a loyal heart, just as Noah did when he built the ark. So Abraham needed to offer a symbolic condition, just like the loyal heart of Noah when he built the ark. Next, how could Abraham restore the position of Ham? Ham was to have represented Abel, the most beloved of God. Since Satan claimed Ham, God needed to claim someone whom Satan loved most. This is the reason God called Abraham, who was the firstborn of Terah, an idolator. When we read the Bible, to whom of the three sons of Noah, to whom does Abraham descended? Does anyone know from the participants? Have you read from whom does Abraham descended? Is it Shem, Ham, and Noah? There are three sons of Noah. Shem, the first one. Shem, the eldest, and then Noah, the second son, and Japheth is the third son. To whom, who is the descendant of, among the three, who is the descendant of, who is the grandfather, the great-great-great-grandfather of Abraham? Anyone from the participant who knows that?
Ancestor, is it from Javed?
Wild guess. Wild guess will be Shem.
Your wild guess is Shem. Who are the other? Who has another answer?
Another wild guess is from Japheth.
From Japheth. and another wild guess is from Ham.
There are only three. Three
so are only three. Actually, Ham, Abraham descended from Ham. Actually, he is Ham has three sons. Ham has three sons. And one of them, and the firstborn son is Abraham has also two other brothers, and he is Ham has three sons, and then the firstborn is Terah, and then there are other two sons with whom the other son is the son of Ham is the father of Lot. Okay. And then the father, we know very well that the firstborn son represented the evil evil, right? Yeah, and the second son represented supposedly God. But since Ham, who should represent goodness, become the initiator of evil or sin, and also influence his brothers to sin also against God. That's the reason why. And Satan claimed all through Ham's sin that the three sons of Noah were all claimed by God. wala siyang ano, walang mapagpilian si God. So that in the time of Abraham, he needs to restore this so that he could Ham become the most beloved son of ano, son of Satan. And then that's the reason why he took Abraham from the evil world. That's why, that's the reason why na he have gotten, God have also restored that. God has the right to take the most beloved son of Satan also to work with God. That's the story. So Abraham's symbolic offering. So that this is how Abraham was to offer the symbolic offering, just like Noah. God commanded Abraham to offer a dove, a ram, and a heifer. You must the question is why three? Usually they offer only one kind of burnt offering. These three sacrifices symbolizes the cosmos. Just like in the time of Noah, the ark is the symbol of the cosmos. So since the requirement is that you need Abraham, since Abraham inherited the mission of Noah, he need to copy the same mission, even the offering. That's why. So that his offering must also symbolize the whole cosmos, just like the ark, which symbolizes the new cosmos at that time. So that's the reason why. So the three offerings symbolizes the cosmos, which is completed through the stages of growing period. So the three offering also symbolizes the three stages of growing period. The dove symbolizes the formation stage, and the ram the growth stage, and the heifer the completion stage. The dove represented the why did Abraham place the three sacrifices in one altar? It is because Abraham, now in the position of Adam, again, as I said earlier, God has been looking for a restored Adam in all the restoration providences. So Abraham now is standing in the position of Adam as if this is not Abraham, but the representative of Adam before the fall, and he is now to offer sacrifice to God in place of the word of God that was not obeyed by Adam. So Adam, as standing in the position of Adam, Abraham was supposed to restore all at once, yung three. One, the long providence of God, which has conducted through the three providential generations of Adam formation, Noah growth, and Abraham completion. So the failed dispensation of the providence must be restored by the new central figure, which is Abraham. So he needs to restore the three generations of Adam, Noah, and Abraham. The past and the present. Present is Abraham's dispensation. In his symbolic offering, Abraham did not cut the dove into two as he should have, and birds of prey came down and defiled the sacrifices. What does this symbolize? Anong ibig sabihin nun? So, we know the story said, when we read the Bible, we already know that Abraham succeeded in cutting the the heifer and the ram, but was not able to cut the bird or the dove. And this and in conclusion, this made the symbolic offering of Abraham a failure. So what does it mean by not dividing the offering? Not dividing it meant that he offered what had not been wrestled from Satan's position. His mistake had the effect of acknowledging Satan's claim of position over the sacrifices. We know very well that with Adam need to in the sacrifices, good and evil must be separated. In part one of the principle, when we studied that, we need to human beings are in the midway position, wherein we men can either relate to God and relate to Satan. So if cutting of the offering means good and evil must be separated. If you are God, this is God and this is Satan. One half is Satan and one half is God. So that they could separate, so that man cannot be anymore in the midway position. So not cutting it is a mistake because it has an effect of acknowledging Satan's claim over the sacrifices. So hindi pa rin napaghiwalay yung good and evil. That's what makes it a failure. So the reasons the offering had to be divided. First, to restore the situation in Adam's family in which Abel and Cain were divided into a representative of good and representative of evil. So there must be a representative of good and there must be a representative of evil, which is represented by Cain and Abel in Adam's family. Second, to restore the situation of having divided good and evil during the 40 days of Noah. We know very well that during the flood judgment, the good was separated from the evil people. The good people was separated. The good people was the people, the eight people that is inside the ark. And the bad people or the evil people was the one who were drawn through the flood judgment. So that's the reason why the flood judgment was able to separate good and evil. That's why it was proclaimed that Noah became successful in the fulfilling the foundation of faith because he was able to separate good and evil. Third, to make the symbolic condition to separate a realm of good sovereignty out of the universe ruled by Satan. So that's the good sovereignty can be the people within the ark so which is headed by Noah during the time of Noah. Fourth, to make the condition to sanctify the offering by draining out the blood of death. Draining out the blood of death means because when humanity committed the fall or Adam and Eve committed the fall, they formed or entered into blood lineage with Satan. So draining the blood of the sacrifice by cutting it means draining the blood of sin, thus removing the original sin which has entered humanity when they were bound in blood ties with Satan. This is the meaning of why the offering must be divided. These are the internal meaning. And it was it did not happen because the dove was not cut and the issues offering to cut among the other offering to cut, it was not being cut by Abraham. So through this failure in the symbolic offering, all the conditions of God intended to restore through it were lost. So it was lost, even though you succeeded in the difficult of difficult offerings, in the two different offerings, but the issues to cut or to divide was not divided. It is also it means lost. And was Abraham was lost to Satan. As a consequence, Abraham's descendants had to suffer oppression of slavery for 400 years in the land of Egypt. This is a consequence that was spoken by heavenly parent through the angel, because you did not cut in the eye, you did not. You were not able to be successful. The angel revealed to Abraham that his descendants were in God promised this is many descendants will, as promised by God, will be a slave to Egypt in a foreign land. In the providence. And the providence centering on him was prolonged through the generations of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. This is the consequence. First is the 400 years of slavery, and then it is prolonged to the generations of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to his son and to his grandson. After Abraham failed in the symbolic offering, God gave him another chance and commanded him to sacrifice his only son Isaac as a burnt offering. So why is it that God have given Abraham second chance, which was not given to Adam's family and to Noah's family? Why God worked with Abraham again? First, the number 3 represents completion. We learned in part 1 of the divine principle that God is a being of number 3. And he is always working on the number 3. Since the providence to lay the foundation for the Messiah in Abraham's family was the third dispensation, we know very well, Adam, Noah, and Abraham. That's the third dispensation. God's principle required that it conclude this time. So it conclude this time. It conclude this time, but it must be, you know very well, that it must be more difficult. Second, Satan had attacked both Adam and his son Cain, defiling the family over the course of two generations. Hence, according to the principle of restoration through indemnity, God could work to take back Abraham and his son Isaac over the course of two generations. So, it can be justified because Satan have took Adam and his son Cain. So, God in the during the third dispensation, God can take also Abraham and his son Isaac as a payment. We know very well that the simple word for indemnity is payment. Third, even though Abraham failed, God could raise him up and give him another chance to make an offering based on the accumulated merit of Abel and Noah's faithful hearts. Abel and Noah's grateful heart because Abel and Noah has been successful in the foundation of faith.
Foundation
and
of faith.
Tama. In fulfilling the foundation of faith, they become one with in heart with God, right? They follow God's commandment. That is yung faithful. That's what's the meaning of the faithful hearts. So now, since God, as the story goes, God offered Isaac. When Abraham was ready to strike Isaac, Abraham put forth his hand and took the knife to slay Isaac. But the angel of the Lord called him from heaven and said, "Do not lay your hand on the lad or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God." Anybody, very few of you are who have already children, right? But then for those who have children, especially for parents who have only have only one child like me, it is very difficult to offer. I can say that offering my only child is very difficult because I don't have any other child, only mine or only Isaac. So it must be very difficult. But because of that loyal heart with God offering his beloved son, God have seen how, acknowledged just that. And what happened? Abraham sealed to do God's will and his resolute actions carried out with absolute faith, obedience, and loyalty lifted him up to the position of already having killed Isaac. Ito yung sinasabi na dun sa in our introduction that indemnity with lesser indemnity but the value is the same. Parang lifted him up in the position of already having killed Isaac. Even though he did not substantially or killed his child, but he is already in his mind, in his heart, and in the eyes of God, he knows that he is ready to kill his son Isaac in order just to show his obedience to God, that he is one in heart with God and that he wanted to prioritize God's commandment or God's word. Therefore, he completely separated Satan from Isaac. And this is the victory of Abraham, symbolic offering of his son as an indemnity to his first offering. Because Abraham succeeded in his offering of Isaac, the providence of restoration in Abraham's family could be carried on by Isaac. This time, Adam has succeeded in fulfilling the foundation of faith. And then after this success, his success can now be inherited by Isaac. By Isaac being the one who would fulfill the substantial foundation of faith. In this way, Isaac, having inherited Abraham's mission, made the symbolic offering and restored to indemnity the foundation of faith. So, yung foundation of faith that Abraham was successfully completed or accomplished was inherited by Isaac. If you read the Bible during when they are walking to the offering mountain, Isaac was already knew what's happening and what's going on, and he even asked his father where is the offering. So where is the offering? And then Abraham told him that God will provide the offering. But then while Abraham was preparing the offering table, he knew that there are no offering, and yet there he understood that in one of his father's speech, when Isaac found out that there are no offering, he immediately understood that he is the offering, and he actually climbed over the offering table. If you are Isaac, he has this faithful heart also to follow God's will, and the son Isaac, that's the reason why he inherited his father's loyalty to God. He climbed into the offering table, and he lay himself down, and that's the only time that Abraham was tie him up. But he did not, just like a sheep who is even crying when it is being offered. It's like that is like Isaac. That's the reason why he was able to inherit. Father and son was able to become one with God, and Isaac was able to inherit the loyalty of his father. Before Isaac's, so the foundation of substance. So since Isaac has inherited the foundation of his Abraham's mission, now it's time for his sons Esau and Jacob to restore the foundation of substance. Before Isaac's two sons Esau and Jacob could make the substantial offering, Jacob first had to fulfill the indemnity condition to restore the position of Abel. So there must be, just like in the time of Adam, there must be two sons representing good and evil, and this is through the sons of Isaac, Jacob, and Esau. You know very well that even when we read the Bible, even when they are in their mother's womb, Esau and Jacob was already fighting. When they are about to be born, there is a fight in Jewish or in Hebrew, in their faith, in their tradition. In their tradition, it's very important. The firstborn is very important. That's the reason why when they were fighting, Esau was to be born first. Even inside the womb, Esau was able to raise himself. He sent out to the. From his mother's womb, and then the midwife immediately tied the so that they would know who is the firstborn, but then again he was pushed back by Jacob, and then it was but since there is this ribbon, red tie in Esau's wrist, that's the reason why Esau becomes the firstborn, even though Jacob was the first one who came out as a whole from mother's womb, because it was Esau who raised him up from the womb first. So that's why they are not. The firstborn is very important. First, in the fight to restore the birthright of the eldest son in the individual level, Jacob cleverly obtained it from Esau in exchange of some pottage, some bread, and a pottage of lentils. You know very well that when you read the Bible, we already know that Esau is a hunter, and then Jacob loves to stay with his mother. And then one day, in order Jacob obtained the birthright from Esau by in exchange of bread and lentils, because he was so hungry, and then in order for him to eat, Jacob asked him that he would exchange his birthright to him, and Esau gave his permission and was able to eat, and was that's the reason why Jacob was able to obtain your birthright from Esau. So the second, Jacob went to Haran. Because of this, which represented the satanic world, after suffering through 21 years of drudgery, he restored the birthright by gaining family and wealth as his due inheritance. Third, Jacob triumphed in wrestling over an angel at the fort of Jabbok, thereby restoring the dominion over the angel in a substantial struggle. This way, Jacob restored through indemnity the position of angel. There was a story here. The stories are like this. Jacob and were born as twins, and Jacob was Esau's younger brother because of the struggle inside the
mother's womb.
However, Rebecca helped Jacob because she had received a revelation. So if you read the Bible, Rebecca seems to favor Jacob, because Jacob over his son Esau, because she received a revelation that Jacob is a representative of the goodness or the lesser evil. Rebecca wanted the younger brother Jacob to stand in the position as first son by uniting with his older brother. And then that's the reason why Jacob was able to also get the blessing of Isaac by deceiving the blessing of Isaac as the firstborn. In the Jewish tradition, it's very important to get the blessing from the father, so that they will be the one that firstborn, or the one who gets the blessing, will be the inheritor, or will be the subject of the family, the head of the family. And then that's the reason why it was the blessing was given to Jacob. Because of this, Esau become very, because of this deception, first is the birthright and now the blessing, Esau become very angry with Jacob and wanted to kill Esau. In order to not in or again, Rebecca entered in the story, and then he told his son Jacob to run to his brother Laban, and that's the reason why Jacob ran away to run away in Haran and to run away in Haran, and then for 21 years he served his uncle Laban, and then that's the time he was able to gain family and wealth, even though with difficult situation. Alam nyo naman na dinadaya siya ni Laban during that time, di ba? Sa 21 years na yon. By uniting, so after 21 years, Jacob wanted to go back to Canaan to unite with his brother Esau, and wanted to all wealth and glory that he obtained from that 21 years, he offered it to Esau, and that's the reason why Jacob became the initiator of the model course of subjugating Satan. Instead of his brother Esau killing him, he accepted him. He was able to subjugate the anger of his brother Esau. However, Jacob tricked Esau twice in order to take Esau's right of the first son with lentil pottage and his father's blessing, and this is not the path of the principle. So we must remember that this is not the path. Deception is not the path of the principle, but the path of Satan. Thus, it became a condition for Satan's accusation and led to Jacob's 21 years suffering in Haran and fight with the angel. So, yun. Kaya siya naghirap doon sa Haran because of this of the deception na ginawa niya, and also with the fight of the angel. If Jacob wanted to inherit the right of the first son, he should have served his father, brother, with sincere heart, so that he would eventually say, "Yes, you are better than me in all aspects, so you should be the first son." So if Jacob have done this before without loving his brother, serving his brother, because the end result is also the same, right? After 21 years, he also offered this. And then if during the time still in Canaan, he doesn't need to go to he doesn't even need to deceive him, just to serve him with sincere heart, as the father has said. Had Jacob brought his older brother into voluntary submission this way, such an arduous course of indemnity would not have been necessary. So nagpakahirap siya, pero ganun pa rin yung dulo pa rin nagtawag dito. The end is the same. Nag-serve pa rin siya sa brother niya, pero dapat, sayang kasi yung 21 years na paghihirap niya, di ba? Yun yung sinasabi dito. Establishment of the foundation of substance. Isaac's son, Esau and Jacob had to be placed in a divided position of Cain and Abel. They were responsible to fulfill the indemnity condition, to remove the fallen nature and lay the foundation of substance. We have learned this in part 1, chapter 2, wherein, Cain and Abel. Hindi siya. Sorry. They need to fulfill indemnity to a condition. No. Sa section 1 pala siya. I'm sorry. Nung part 2. Nung chapter 1. They need to remove the fallen nature in order to lay the foundation of substance, they need to remove the fallen nature. Standing in the position of Cain and Abel, wherein Abel, in order for Abel to Abel must serve his elder brother so that Cain would recognize Abel. This there should be harmonious interrelationship with brothers, elder brother and younger brother. By restoring dominion over the angel through his victorious fight, he received the name Israel. So, when in his journey back to Canaan, Jacob asks his wives to go first, dividing his wealth and family into Rachel and Leah, and then Leah and Rachel, and then he followed them afterwards, but then he fight with an angel during this time, and then he did not Jacob did not yield that to the angel until the angel pronounced him the winner. And that because of that, and he even broke the hip of the angel, so that signifying the restoration of the central part of the sexual part of sexual part, which were in the human fall represent through the angel. That's why in the victory, in the fight over the angel, in the fork of Jabo, Jacob was named Israel as a symbol of his victory over the angel. When Esau opened his arm and affectionately welcomed Jacob, as he returned to Canaan, they fulfilled the indemnity condition to remove the fallen nature. This is their victory restored to indemnity horizontally in one family, the long vertical course of history in which God had been working to restore the foundation of substance. This time, in the family of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the foundation of substance was successfully laid. At last, the foundation for the Messiah family foundation was established in Isaac's family, as he inherited this from his father Abraham. However, by Abraham's time, fallen people had already built up satanic nations, which could easily overpower Abraham's family. You know very well that there are three sons of Noah, which is from Shem and Japheth. So after the flood judgment, they divided the land into three. One third is for Shem, one third is for for Ham, and then one third is for Noah. So they have these families, the families of Shem and Japheth, have already built satanic nations. And then over, and the other sons of Ham already built satanic nations. And then this is the reason why during in the providence of God, it is only family foundation that has been
established,
accomplished, so that Hence, the Messiah could not have safely come on that foundation. So hence, Jacob's family entered Egypt, centering on Joseph, and went through the 400 years of indemnity, trying to build the national foundation for the Messiah. That's the reason why we know very well that because of the failed first symbolic offering, there is the first indemnity is that slavery, 400 years slavery, and then that's the reason why. And we know, as we read in the Bible, the Jacob's family entered into Egypt because of famine. Yung taggutom, pumasok sila ng Egypt. Pagkatapos, pumunta sila sa Egypt na, pero bago nila ginawa yun, binenta nila yung kapatid na nila na si Joseph. Yun yung pinakabunso nila, yung anak ni Jacob kay Rachel. Isa sa mga anak ni Jacob kay Rachel. Galit na galit sila sa kanya, kaya sa kanila, kasi yun, na si Joseph, nung binenta nila, naging, si Joseph is yung, remember yung Joseph the dreamer, tapos dahil dun sa gift niya na yon, naging advisor siya nung Pharaoh dun sa Egypt. Kaya sila, dun sila nakapasok. That's the reason why. Pero ang reason dito is that for them to serve the 400 years indemnity. So nagkita-kita sila doon, magkakapatid. The story of Joseph was also interesting. Please read it. God had regarded Abraham, Jacob's model, first to subjugate Satan. So we know now subjugating Satan means making Satan into submission, voluntary submission. So that in this way we can restore humanity. So that we can restore the lordship of human, of God's children, over the angels. So God regarded Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob as the same person with respect to his will, even though they were three different individuals. Accordingly, Jacob's success meant Isaac's success, and Isaac's success meant Abraham's success. Therefore, the providence of restoration centering on Abraham, through it was extended to Isaac and Jacob, came to be regarded in the sight of God as having been accomplished in Abraham's own generation without any prolongation. After this, after Jacob becomes successful, usually God proclaim himself or introduce himself through the angels by saying, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So, this is the reason why God says that. And this is how God recognizes that this the success of the three of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's why in the verse, I am God, the father of, the father of God, of Abraham, God of Isaac, and God of Jacob, indicates that although they were three generations, God regarded as one generation, his ancestor who collectively accomplished his will. So ito yung model course that the Jacob's model course to that the next central figure will follow in order to subjugate Satan. And this is the reason, this will be the model course. And this is how also followed by Moses and Jesus Christ in the image course in the next chapter that we will be discussing in the next chapter. Jacob's model course to subjugate Satan. By receiving the name Israel, Jacob laid the groundwork upon which this chosen people would be established, and by fulfilling the indemnity condition to remove the fallen nature, the victorious complete he victoriously completed the model course to subjugate Satan. This is also the reason why Israel, the king Canaan as a location, as a place, become also the name from Canaan, it becomes Israel because of the victory of Jacob. It is where Israel came from, which is Israel, the nation of Israel, is usually called in the Old Testament as Canaan before it became Israel. And then Moses, Jesus, and even the people of Israel would walk this course after the pattern set by Jacob. Lessons from Abraham's course. First, Abraham's course demonstrates that God's predestination concerning the manner in which his will is fulfilled is conditional. So, even though the predestination of God, again, is absolute, but fulfilling his will through human beings is conditional upon the fulfillment, successful fulfillment of a human portion of responsibility. Second, Abraham's second course shows us that when human beings fail to complete their responsibility, the fulfillment of God's will is always delayed, and its restoration requires fulfillment of greater indemnity. That's what I have said. Even though God would give you the second chance, you must also, we cannot rejoice still, because it means if God would give us the second chance, it is more difficult, 10 times or even 100 times more difficult. But still, we need to be very grateful because we are given the chance, the second chance. So if we are given the second chance, we should not miss it or fail it this time. So that applying or following Abraham's example. Third, Abraham's cutting the sacrifices into provides the lesson of each of us must divide ourselves as an offering to separate good and evil. We know very well that cutting ourselves is difficult. Especially when we say cutting ourselves, it means cutting ourselves from our comfort zones. The comfort zones, something that we are comfortable. Comfortable in the sense that we are comfortable with our, this is the way we have been nurtured, this is the way we have living our life. And if we cut this or separate with this and follow God's will, it is always, the path is always difficult. And also, one of the things that you must also be realize, brothers and sisters, is that even though we are from the side of even if we are the most evil person of this world, if God have chosen us, God always give us a chance, and that there is already there is also God has a way of choosing us, and that's what he did with choosing Abraham from the satanic side. So all of us, even though we are doing evil, even though we have done so much sin against God, if God chose us, so we must also be grateful and truly follow Heavenly Parent when He chose us, because this is how Heavenly Parent love most all of us. And this ends the section 3 of chapter 1 of the part 2 of the divine principle.
Yes, thank you, Ate Melina. Give a big round of applause. Yeah, as we studied about the part 2, the in the section 2 and section 3 about the providence of restoration in Noah's family and Abraham's family. So through this, God is really amazing how he really find a person or a central figure who could be able to fulfill his will. But yeah, kahit na, yun nga, kahit na ano pa rin, even though Noah, even though in the time of Noah established the foundation of faith, but still there's a part that he failed, and God chose another person, which is Abraham's family, to continue the mission that God, or the will, God's will that he wanted to fulfill. But in the time of Abraham, how Abraham have a very, which is a good example of life of faith, how we could be able to like Abraham, parang ano siya ba, napaka faithful niya talaga, even though his only begotten son, he is willing to offer it. So when we related to our life, how we could be able to, yung ganun ba, how we could have that kind of life of faith. So medyo brothers and sisters, so it's time for now to give a reflection, or do you have any question that our lecturers are ready to answer? Or I think maybe we can have the reflection. Ano po ba? So, sino po ang, who is willing to, ano po, maunang mag-volunteer or let us, our lecturers, kung sino yung mga i-volunteer nila para maunang mag- reflection, to give a reflection. Meron po ba? Kuya Erwin, ikaw na mag...
Mamili?
Ikaw na mamili, Kuya Erwin.
Baka may mag-volunteer. So,
meron po ba?
So, we could be able to... We all have learned and we've observed to see that there are many things that we've got from lessons from those central figures. And yeah, if we are going to relate in our life, ano kaya yun? Do you have any experience or personal experience facing this kind of struggles also happens between our central figures? So, any volunteer?
Kuya Herwin?
Yes, Kuya. Kuya Ate.
This is just... for more clarification, because I think I missed out on this. But I think I have a little insight, but I wanted to hear from you and the other mentors of ours. Yeah, I learned, I think everybody of us learned that God is a God of numbers and he worked through numbers. And then we also learned that Noah, actually Abraham, had inherited his faith from Noah, right? And then, because Noah manifested his faith to God by making the ark on the top of the mountain in 120 years. And what does this 120 years represent? I would like to know.
Like 120 years, eh? Terelina.
Because I think I missed out on that. I didn't hear very clearly.
Terelina. Yeah.
Why of all the numbers he chose 120 years? Why did not choose 40? Why did not choose 70? Or 210? Why 120?
Okay.
Thank you.
Oh, yun ni, di ba? Si Sir Hel. Siguro ika-clarify talaga ni Sir Randy or baka mas alam ni Sir Julius kasi nakita ko na yan si Sir Julius or Sir ano. But then, 120 is centering on the number 12 and then there are in the four position foundation, there are three object partners of God, right? That is Adam, Eve, and yung child niya. Or kung sa first blessing, there are three object partners. So there are three object partners, and then each of these 3 object partners must form a 4 position. Meron silang kaya sa times 4 and it represent yung 10 generations kaya 120 kasi 3 times 4 times 20 times 10 diba? Which is 10 generations, that's why it is 120 years. So to that represent the represent yung obedience mo and becoming one with God. Kasi yun you need to in forming the four position foundation, you need to be one with God, di ba? To be one with God in all of the positions in the four position foundation need to become to fulfill yung three object purpose kaya 3 times 4 times 10 generations na kailangan ma-purify ni God yung lineage after the failure of the failure of Adam's family or Cain and Abel.
Okay. Thank you.
Parang ganun siya nakikita.
All right po.
Hindi ko lang alam kung ganun siya.
Anyway, salamat po. So, sige. Reflection ko na lang. So, maraming salamat, Ate Lerlina. Ay, Kuya Herwin, may isa a-add po ba kayo?
Yeah,
hindi na, kasi mag-ano na. Kasi nag-aas na ng reflection eh. Pero, syempre, pag may i-add pa kayo, I would be glad to hear that.
Yes.
Research ka.
Okay, no problem.
About the numbers, we will actually know the significance that in the next mga lecture. And I will try to find na galing kay Pro Father about these numbers. Send sa inyo. But yeah, later sa like I think chapter 2 or 3. Yeah, sa part 2 ng divine principle. I-explain natin yung significance ng 21 days, 21, 127, 144. Yeah, all those numbers. I-explain siya.
Ah, okay, sige po. Thank you because I'm just really curious because of all the central figures, I mean, I think we have learned that in every level, we have to establish a proficient foundation. I think that's given. But it's just it's not very clear to me why did God chose 120 in Noah's family.
Ate, meron po pa lang isa. Yun kasi, Yung isa kasi ate, di ba, the ark represent the cosmos, di ba? The new cosmos. And ang cosmos is that, ano, ang cosmos three is levels. Comprises of yung heaven and earth, di ba? Yung incorporeal sa corporeal world. Eh, ang heaven, ang number ng heaven is 3. Ang number ng earth is, 4.
Okay.
Ate, kasi re-restore mo yung re-restore mo yung kasi yung ark is the new cosmos. Kasi nga, new beginning siya. So, kailangan, re-restore ni God yung kailangan ng 10 generations, kaya na-multiply yun. So, kaya nga, minultiply mo yung number ng heaven, tapos yung number ng ng earth, plus through the yung pag-fulfill mo ng three object purpose in the four position foundation. That's the reason why na tapos 10 generations after, kaya siya ganon. Kaya sa 100,
okay,
parang ganon siya. Kasi cosmos yung new cosmos kasi yung arc di ba? Kaya kailangan ma-restore yung 120. Kaya sa 120, para yun yung parang yun yung creation, yung represented the creation, yung period na creation, creating the new cosmos. Parang ganon. Ganon siguro ko siya nakikita kasi nga nakalimutan ko kaninang una na yun yung cosmos. Yung arc is representative of the new cosmos.
Maraming salamat ate for that very actually okay, had help.
Mag-aaral natin yun later on dun sa hindi ko alam po anong chapter, baka yung next chapter na ba siya, Sir Herwin? Yung providential numbers.
Yeah.
Parang okay. Sa chapter 3 or basta.
Chapter
3. So anyways, kasi if you are going to read the section 2 of the Noah's family, it was not explained the providential purpose of 120 days, why it happens. It only explained the 40 days blood judgment. But the 120 days, it was not explained there in the divine principle, section 2. But in the later chapter, we will explain it more. And we explain the purpose of it. So thank yes, thank you so much. And then my question dito sa chat box kay Brother Jonathan Ibatados. Is foundation of substance already fulfilled by True Father? Because we know that one of his son, Yong Jin Moon, is not united in him.
That's a very funny question. Sorry.
Yeah. Yeah. Somehow. Yeah. This is I cannot say it is funny, but this is really serious actually. Because
seriously?
We are talking about the family of true parents, and if we cannot, Me myself, I am not in the position to explain this one.
Yeah, I rather reserve to say no, not to discuss about it, maybe.
Because we cannot comprehend the plan of God actually. Sometimes
precisely.
What happens to the family of true parents, only God knows, the providence knows. Even now, there is another some members having this making this book about true parents' victory. But when you talk about the family of true parents, actually, let's leave that to
them.
To them. Because everybody have our portion of responsibility.
Right.
So even though during the time of Adam and Eve, even if you think even if Adam and Eve reached perfection, and after that one, is it possible for them to fall or not? Yes, there is still a possibility, even if they reach perfection. Because we have this what we call portion of responsibility. But at that time, if they reach perfection, centering upon God, then it is like 2% possibility of the fall. So it would, it is very hard to fall, but there's a possibility, but very, very small amount of possibility. So it is not assurance. If we fulfill our responsibility, then we will fall. That's my point. But in the time of true parents, so everybody have our portion of responsibility. And in true father's family, so the children also have their portion of responsibility. But when we talk about substance, foundation of substance, let's look at the foundation of parents. For how many years father established already foundation of faith and substance? I think ang pinupokusan ni Jonathan dito is about family. But beyond family, father already established this one. Even in the family, it's just about this is a family problem that one of themselves know, only God knows something. But let's look at the foundation of this. And I can really say, we can really testify that the father already laid the foundation of faith and foundation of substance. Look at now, many religious leaders, heads of states also knew about true parents.
Because we know that one of his sons,
so yeah, and I hope you understand. Oh, even father before he died, right? The last of one of his last prayer, sabi niya, I have accomplished everything.
Completed and I have completed.
Yeah,
I perfected and I have accomplished.
Yeah.
Already Kuya Herwin.
Yes.
Kuya Herwin, if you would allow me to say something. I rather wanted to say, yeah, I strongly believe that if and when Adam and Eve had reached perfection, there is no possibility for us to fall. You know why? It is that time when we finally reach perfection that we can truly resonate with the heart of God, meaning there is no more chance for Satan to invade, meaning we have God has direct dominion over humanity. So I would not say we have the chance to fall, and we still have the chance to fall, even if we have the portion of responsibility. Because to me, our portion of responsibility is only to be exercised. It has to be exercised, though, still after perfection. But more on that time when we haven't been in the perfection stage yet, because it is the time when God has no direct dominion to us. So that's it. We have to really fulfill it with our portion of responsibility. And in the case of our true parents' family, the reason why could have been, maybe there is such a thing as factions that we know at the moment. But we know also very well that the true children is not... is already exempted from the influence of the secular world. And we know very well that the foundation of Satan is already worldwide also. So it has dominated the world already. So yeah, the true parents already victoriously, I should say, had victoriously laid the foundation of faith and substance beyond family. It's just that at this moment, yeah, I will reiterate, even us, true parents, even the second generation, is not exempted from being influenced from the secular world. That's why it could have been happening this way. And yeah, Satan will always find means to really want to accuse. So this is the challenge in our part now. How are we going to look at this from God's perspective? Instead of, I hope we should be united in looking at things from God's point of view, instead of looking it critically from our own point of view, for us to be able to really accomplish and become a co-creator, or should we say contributor in the realization of God's providence. So I hope, brothers and sisters, we should remind ourselves, and we have all the responsibility to remind each other and help each other in that aspect.
Yung ano about the Adam and Eve becoming perfect. Actually, if Adam and Eve become perfect, it is their children who has. If you think it is their children, I think in yung dapat i-clarify natin. Yung children nila ni Adam and Eve, even if they become perfect, their children is not exempted up to their responsibility. Their children doesn't mean they also become perfect already when they are born. They need to be perfect themselves. So there is a possibility that their children will also commit the sin. So yun yun, because everyone, as we are born, we have our portion of responsibility. And that is also the same with our true father, with the true children. So even if our true father and true mother are perfect individuals, their children need to, the true children need to pass through the same process to perfect themselves also. So that is their individual responsibility. Remember, it's not just every one of us individually has to pass through the first blessing and then second blessing. So substantially, Father have laid the foundation of substance, not just the family level, but cosmic level. So remember also actually, if we are going to observe and examine it carefully, true parents basically sacrifice their family just to work in for the worldwide providence. So kung tutusin, we are contributor of that, and then they become the true children were not really taken care of by our true parents, just like they take care of their evil, their king children, which is that is us. Most of the time, they cared more of their king children. Bakit? Kasi that's the principle. Sino ba mas madami, di ba? It's sino bang mas whole? Ano bang mas madami? Pinipili nila yung mas madami kasi sa children nila. Parang inyong ganun yun eh. So, ako personally, I cannot blame the true children kung meron man silang ganung feeling towards us or meron bang silang ganung feeling, because hindi naman talaga sila na take care ng true parents, hindi dahil sa ayaw nila, kundi they were sacrificed just for the for the whole, so mas madami. Yun yung dapat natin tinitingnan. So pero ang first and foremost, everyone, kahit na children ka pa ng true parents, kahit na second gen ka pa, third gen ka pa, fourth gen ka pa, parang ganun, you still have your portion of responsibility. And hindi ka po pwede, yun yung pinag-usapan natin sa support patch pa yan. Hindi ka pwede mag-shortcut. Everybody needs to pass through to become perfect individually, then
first stages of growth.
Oo, talagang meron siyang and kahit na sino pa, wala talagang makakagawa niyan kundi ikaw lang as individual. And then after that, if you perfect yourself individually, then you can move to or advance to the next level, which is family perfection. And yun, the two children are not exempted in passing through the individual perfection also. They have their own portion of responsibility. Yung may nabasa ako, sabi ni Father, ako bahala sa mga anak ko. Ako responsible sa kanila. Huwag nila silang pansinin. Ang pansinin natin, yung worldwide providence natin.
Saka, ate, I would like to quote through Father's words that I think I cannot forget. That he said, a time will come that what would just remain is tradition and education. I would like to agree with you na we all have a portion of responsibility and we have to go through the process of growing. But if you compare through Father's family to the Ato Adam's family, it's like this. Adam's family at the moment. Kaya nga si Adam and Eve, Adam is the tree of life and Eve is the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And then we know na if and when, kaya sinabi ko na if there is no chance for us to fall, if Adam and Eve is perfection, is because definitely Adam, Eve will become the tree of knowledge of good, no longer evil. So, which means at that time, she is very capable of raising her children perfectly to raise them up and guide them to become perfect. Also to become perfect as they have pioneered that path. And then and compared to the two parents, time now, it's really different. It's really a larger scale of restoration they have to go through because the foundation of Satan has already expanded to the worldwide level. That's the very reason why the two parents cannot attend the true children. And even Father, you know, Father's heart, when he was already, I think I heard it from Dr. Young's guidance, and he said that Father's heart was like really one regret. There are regrets, actually, two regrets that he has in heart, that he cannot attend his own children, and he has to pass through this mission to true mother, you know, because how difficult it is for true mother to carry on to Father's mission. And in that way, we should reflect to ourselves, what could this be? How can we able to contribute on this particular mission? What is our role instead of like looking at the failures or the shortcomings from our true family, you know? Because it's not really easy. So I really would like to say, if had Adam and Eve perfected with perfection, I should say there is no room for man to fall, to or failing anymore. Because even though we have to go through the three stages of growth, I repeat, Adam and Eve could perfectly guide them to do the same path that they had pioneered towards reaching perfection. There would be no more restoration. There would be no more, you know, this fall and this providence of restoration. There's no need for this to exist anymore. It's all just, things will just come naturally. Things will just... growing was just part of the, you know, the three stages will just come naturally to every human being. I so believe in that. I'm sorry, I'm just like,
yes, thank you so much.
But I really believe so.
That's why they actually this is one of my questions before really, and it answers actually. And hinahanap ko nito, I'm trying to find in the GP. Which part? Kasi I found out answer actually. I really want. We talk that with Sir Andy. Yeah. Anyway, that is why.
Yeah, I'm so excited about that.
We could deeper understand why is it there is, even if there is perfection on the children, still not assurance. Because let's see if they have children, are they going to give the commandment not to eat the fruit, the children?
Depending on the education of the parents, actually, I would say.
Yeah, they will have to. Same with God. God gave us the commandment. And same with Adam and Eve. If there is
perfect, the parents could, Kuya, if the parents would absolutely unite with God, then the children will have, because it would be the tradition. That is the tradition that True Father is trying to emphasize. I don't think that he means another tradition. It is the tradition of having absolute faith, love, and obedience to our Creator, the Heavenly Parents. And the education is on the hands of the parents. That's our responsibility already, you know. So I think, I'm so excited.
This is very crucial.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to... that is why
me myself, I'm having, I feel like I'm not, I'm trying to choose the right word that I, how to explain to other people. It's really dangerous, actually. That is why I'm always reading through Father's words, because whatever I'm saying, I should say it based on through Father's words, not just based on my understanding. Don't use actually based
sorry,
on
sorry, please.
Me myself, if I did not read that through Father's words, that is why I will not really share to other people. I'm so sorry, but I cannot. As long as I will not read it personally. Even if the leader says that one, even if Sir Randy give lecture, I not totally agree unless I will not study it myself and read it from true parents' words. To tell you honestly, even the internal guidance of the leaders, I will not believe it directly. I will have to study it from true father's words directly, that what they're saying is true. That is why it's very important also that what we are saying, don't just believe what we are saying. You have to study it with your own. We have the responsibility, and that's my point. We all have responsibility. Even though we are sharing to you the right thing to do, but it doesn't work that way because you have to do it. Yeah, anyway, time na. So, maraming mga tayong mag-usapan. But anyway, yes. And thank you so much for tonight. Wala tayong wala nang reflection. I'm sorry. Anyway, this is really, this is good point actually. So, ito yung isa sa maganda sa 21 days na to. We could really, we are free to share, but let's, dapat tingnan din natin. Really, because we are talking about life and death here. Life and death of our brothers and sisters. So, thank you, God. Anyway, yes, Ate Jinky, you can close.
Yes, thank you for that. Pero, you run out of, wala lang, ano ba, 10 na. So, I think, maybe next time you could prepare your reflection. If you have any questions, Popo, and then you can, I think you can send to our lecturers, and then they can answer. Yeah, and they can help you.
Sana nasagot yung tanong kay Jonathan. Okay, yes. If you still have any question, you can ask me directly or other lecturers directly.
Then you can send them. Yeah, they can help you. So, yeah, without then we can close na officially. And may I ask Kuya Greg to the closing prayer.
All right. Please join me in prayer. Our beloved heavenly parents and true parents of heaven and earth and humankind, we would like to express our deepest gratitude first and foremost, Father, for giving us the opportunity to listen, to hear and be present, Father, for this 21 days seminar. Even though, Father, that this seminar has enlightened us in a way of understanding more of you, our heavenly parent, but more importantly, Father, it is also a moment to wherein we are now in the position to also clarify things and understand deeply how our beloved true parents path and have journeyed to give us the enlightenment of this divine principle. We know of a fact, Father, that our true parents have toiled and have faced a lot of difficulties, especially in terms of life of faith. So, Father, I would like to really pray that being as a member of the Unification Movement or as a member of Unification Church, it is also our sole responsibility on how we will be able to enlighten and open our hearts and minds, embracing the new truth of our true parents. And most especially, Father, on how we can also practice this in our daily life. We know also, Father, that being an ideal person is really a very, very difficult task. But then again, our true parents have already paved the way for us to follow. Thus, we would like to really pray and thank you enough for this moment. And I know, Father, that each and everyone has also questions or even still wants to have clarification of faith in terms of understanding our teaching based on the divine principle. So, Father, thank you once again for this moment, for our lecturers that you have used as your tongue to convey your message. But more importantly, Father, thank you very much for your heart, your knowledge, your intellect, and most of all, Father, for the sharing of the love of our true parents to us members. Thank you, and we'd like to offer this moment to you. On behalf of my brothers and sisters who are attending this 21-day seminar, also, Father, for the brothers and sisters, the staff of this 21-day seminar, may you always be with us, enlighten us more in our journey of understanding your truth. Again, thank you, and we'd like to offer this moment to you in the name of our beloved true friend, this I offer and pray. Adieu.
Thank you, Uya. Let's give a big thanks to our lecturers for tonight. Yeah, thank you.
Sure tayo, te.
Ikaw na kuya mag-ano.
Okay, open your cameras, brothers and sisters. Shock ba kayo lahat? That's okay. That's part of 21 days. Okay, Ate Cheribel, Ate Bel, Kuya Julius. Okay, so that's okay. Heart, brothers and sisters, tanong ang nida. Vision 2027. Sungi. All right. Thank you so much.
Yes po. Then don't forget po to send your reflection for tonight po kay Ate Monina.
Okay. Thank you so much. Yes, pag yung mga question na next meeting na lang, okay?
Okay.
Kasi hahanapan pa namin yung sagot.
Let's work Erwin, together.
Yes.
Erwin, I just want to include something because it's like also a research maybe that you're going to make.
Yeah.
I know that I may have had the answer before, but I'm kind of blacked out on it. The question of, this is like an external question, but then again, it's also part of out of curiosity. Can you please make a research on why did God provided these three animals to Abraham to sacrifice, being represented by heifer, ram, and dove. It means, for me, it's like there is something symbolic as to why God chose these three specific animals, wherein, for me, there are a lot of animals to sacrifice, but God chose a three for Adam to offer.
Animals?
So, just give me the answer soon, or, yeah, it's a research that I would like to listen from you soon. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kuya.
And have a good evening.
And then, you can research also, brothers and sisters.
yeah, I will.
So let's all our ideas then, let's add. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Have a good evening.
Have a good evening.
meron si Oliver. Therefore, this first.
I'll screenshot this and read it later. Okay, thank you very much. And again, have a good evening to all. See you soon. Bye.
Thank you. Actually, nakita ko yun dati. Hinahanap ko din yun kung anong meaning ng tatlo.